Hi, everybody, and thank you for joining this talk. Today we will talk about the open source technology, which is called OpenCalSite. So let me share my screen and let's get started. Let me introduce myself first. My name is Vladimir Ozerov. I'm the founder of the company Querify Labs, and where we create and build the core components of the database systems, such as query optimizers, query engines, storages, and stuff like that. And before that, I worked for about 8 years on the in-memory data grid products, such as Apache Ignite and Hazelcast. Specifically, I worked on SQL layers in these products. And currently, basically in our company, we scale this expertise in SQL. And also, I'm committed to a couple of open source projects, such as Apache CalSite and Apache Ignite. So, as mentioned, today we will talk about the product called Apache CalSite. But let's do one step back and discuss what is the current state of the SQL engines in the modern data stacks. And over the past decade, we observed a significant increase in the interest to the distributed SQL query engines. And if maybe 10 years ago or so, when we thought about SQL, we thought mainly on the classical relational databases such as Oracle or SQL Server. Nowadays, we have SQL interfaces to plenty of different systems, such as big data or analytical systems like, Press or Snowflake. We have SQL interfaces to compute and streaming systems like Kafka. We have SQL in-memory systems as well. And in addition to this, it is worth mentioning that in our daily practice, we observe significant interest to SQL, to the custom SQL engines, which build even in non-IT companies for different reasons. For example, in some companies, it could be pretty interesting to have a single entry point for SQL queries, which the engine could then spread between different sources and then merge them back, right? Like in classical federated systems like Presto. And given all this variety of use cases for SQL, it becomes interesting whether it is possible to speed up the implementation of the new SQL engines, right? And imagine, if you think about what is the typical path of the SQL query when you submit it to the system, then often there is the so-called query optimizer or query planner component in the database or engine, which does the following. First, it accepts the query string that you submitted and performs the syntax and semantic analysis. And as a result of this operation, we internally, the engine gets the so-called syntax tree, which is basically the object representation of the original query string. After that, many engines perform the translation of this syntax tree to some alternative representation, which is often called intermediate representation, which is more suitable for different relational optimizations, such as filter pushdown, join reorder, and stuff like that. And this approach is implemented, for example, in Spark, in Presto, in Flink, and in Hive, and other systems like that. And then, once you have this intermediate representation, what you want to do is that you would like to apply many, many different transformations on top of this tree to find the better execution plan. And for sure, as already mentioned, one of the very common and typical optimizations is filter pushdown, right? When you attempt to ensure that your stream of data is filtered as early as possible, because usually it increases the performance of the engine. But this optimization is only one of many dozens or even hundreds of other optimizations that you may potentially apply to your query to have the better plan. And after that, you finally submit your execution plan to your backend. And in database papers or database community, there is the consensus that implementation of all these things that I just discussed is usually one of the most painful and difficult parts, especially especially all the problems around the transformations on top of the intermediate representation. But now imagine that there is the system that can do all these things for you and provide you sufficient extension points to customize the workflow, to customize the integration with respect to the requirements of your engine. And this system exists, this Apache Calcite. Apache Calcite is a framework which consists of individual components that you may combine in different combinations to build your own query optimizer. Specifically, in Apache Calcite, there is the fully-fledged SQL parser, which can parse and see SQL queries. It has the semantic analyzer, which conducts the semantic analysis. It also has the dedicated intermediate representation and a special facility to translate the syntax tree into the intermediate representation. And finally, it comes with a very rich set of different optimization rules and other optimization techniques that you may apply to your plan to find a better way to execute the given query. And combined, also, Apache Calcite provides a lot of extension points to each of those components. Specifically, you may provide a custom syntax, custom semantic analysis, semantic correctness rules, custom optimization rules, a custom cost model, and stuff like that. And in this talk, I would like to guide you through these four dedicated components and give you a high-level overview of the capabilities of Apache Calcite. Because nowadays, this is one of the very hot open source projects in Apache Software Foundation, and it is used in the projects like Apache Flink, Apache Hive, in Dremio, in for example Apache Drill, and many others. So and this really useful tool. Okay, so now let's go over these components one by one and discuss their capabilities. So first of all, as mentioned, when you submit the query to the engine, it all starts with the parsing stage. At this point, you would like to just iterate over your string and construct some syntax tree that reflects the syntactic structure of the query. And if you think how you may implement the parser from how you may parse the query, of course you may always implement the parser by hand. But usually this is pretty time-consuming task. Even if you use some parser generators like Bison or Yak, you still need to write a lot of tests. You need to build the definition of your parser, and this is still pretty painful. In Apache Calcite, you have the pre-built parser, which is ready to use, and you may literally parse your query into the syntax tree with no more than two lines of code. And I mean it. This is really trivial with Apache Calcite. And behind the scenes, Apache Calcite uses JavaCC parser generator. And in the code base of Apache Calcite, you may find default definition of the parser in the jar files in the artifacts of Apache Calcite. You have the pre-built generated parser, but in addition to this, what you may do is that you may also provide the custom extensions to this parser, because you may open the definition of the parser of the JavaCC parser generator and simply add your custom syntax. For example, add custom DDL commands, or maybe extend the select syntax, maybe introduce some custom functions or custom constructs. This is all doable with Apache Calcite with relatively little efforts. But if you are okay with the built-in Apache Calcite parser, which is, by the way, ANSI compliant, then you may literally start, you may literally parse the query in two lines of code. So this is a pretty exciting thing. Next, in query optimization, the next step is usually the so-called semantic analysis. This is the step when we would like to verify that the syntax tree that we have after the parsing stage is basically semantically correct with respect to the SQL semantics. For example, imagine that you have the group by group by statement, but you do not have the relevant aggregation functions. In this case, we should throw an exception. Or maybe you refer to some functions which are not present in your system, or maybe you provide some arguments to the functions with incorrect types of arguments, or maybe you refer to tables or columns that do not exist in your schema. So we need to verify that the syntax tree is actually semantically correct. And usually, again, this is pretty painful step in compiler theory. And usually this task cannot be automated in any way. I mean that unlike the parsing stage, you cannot, for example, build some simplified definition and then generate the logic to do the semantic analysis. Instead, the semantic analysis is usually performed by hand, and this is again very painful thing. Luckily, in Apache Calcite, we again have the component, the dedicated component, which is called SQL validator, which can do this for us. This component requires us to provide the schema, and schema is basically a set of interfaces that you may implement to instruct Apache Calcite which database objects like tables or views you have. And once you do this, you integrate your schema with this SQL validator, and then you run the validation. And as a result of this, you still receive the syntax tree, but this time this syntax tree have all the database objects, all the columns and functions already resolved, and all the types already deduced for your query. So after the validation stage completed successfully, you know for sure that your query is valid from the perspective of either unsQL semantics or the semantics of your engine. And at this point, you may also extend this validator to provide some custom to add some custom validation steps. And at this point, since you still have the access to the syntax tree, you're able to implement your engine to allow your engine to throw very sensible and very concise error messages with the precise positions in the query string. To help users understand what was the exact source of the error that you throw. So again, this is pretty exciting component. Okay, let's move on. As mentioned, in the engines, usually you do not once you start the optimization of the query, you usually do not want to optimize the syntax tree. The reason for this is that the syntax tree follows the strict semantics of the SQL syntax standard, right? And this standard is pretty complicated. For example, if you think of what is the select statement in terms of the syntax tree, this is a kind of a very complicated node, which has a lot of child nodes. You need to have the dedicated from clause, dedicated group by, having, and stuff like that, right? And if you think on how you may, for example, do the filter pushdown or do some some other optimizations on top of the syntax tree, then usually you realize that it is not really easy to apply any sensible transformations on such a tree. This is the reason why many engines translate the syntax tree into more suitable form. And usually during this translation, the engines try to convert the syntax tree into a tree of operators that resembles the classical operators from the relational algebra. And operators are like scan when you would like to scan some data source, project or filter when you would like to do the projection, I mean change the attributes or do the filtering by removing some rows. Here you may also see the aggregation operator or window aggregation, join operators, set operators, sort operator, and many engines like Presto, Spark, and stuff like that, they all have more or less the same representation. Of course, there are some subtle differences between them, but generally they follow this approach. And The situation is the same with Apache Cloud Site. In order to do some advanced optimizations, you need to translate your syntax tree into the tree of relational operators. And again, in Apache Cloud Site, there is the dedicated component which can do this for you. So you just instantiate the special object, you invoke the dedicated API, and in a couple of lines of code, you basically translate the syntax tree into a very suitable and very simple tree of relational operators, which is a very good starting point for the subsequent optimizations. And now we finally move into the most, I would say, interesting part of this stuff. So what are the actual optimizations that Apache Cloud Site can do for you? I would say that all the optimizations could be split in roughly two big groups. The first group is the so-called rule-based optimizations, which we will discuss in the subsequent slides. The other group of optimizations are custom optimizations, which are implemented in the form of a visitor, which traverses your relational tree and attempts to do some useful rewrites. And in Apache Cloud Site, I would like to mention two very useful and very widely used visitors that significantly simplifies your plans. The first one is the so-called field trimmer. This is a relatively straightforward visitor which can traverse your tree and attempt to find the columns that are not really used in your query. It could often happen if you, for example, do the scan and then you apply some filter on top of it and then you extract, two fields right from it. And Apache Cloud Site may realize that, for example, you do not need to pass all the fields to your filter, but instead you would like to throw away as many fields as possible early on and only then pass the remaining useful fields to the parent operators. So field trimmer, the goal of the field trimmer is to analyze your plan and figure out which fields are not used and could be safely removed from the plan without affecting the semantics. The second very important and very useful facility is the so-called subquery elimination. So you know that one of the most complicated things in SQL queries, especially from the database implementer perspective, is the subqueries. Because you may have subqueries in many different parts of your query, right? So you may have derived tables in the from clause. So you may have the scalar subqueries in the select clause, right? And usually for engines, it's very difficult to operate on them, especially if you have some non-trivial engine like distributed query engine, for example. They are not really suitable for execution of the subqueries through the nested loops or stuff like that. And the other source of complexity is that sometimes we may have the subqueries, which are basically correlated subqueries, which means that in order to execute the subquery, you need to access some variables from the outer query. And luckily, in Apache Cloud Site, there is a dedicated set of utilities which allows you to completely get rid of the subqueries in your plan. And there is actually the formal proof in academia, which proves that every subquery, be it correlated or not, could be rewritten into a sequence of joins, aggregates, and probably some other operators. And Apache Cloud Site can actually do this. For sure, in some cases, Apache Cloud Site does it in a not very optimal way. And sometimes you need to complement Apache Cloud Site with some additional logic. For example, this is what Apache Flink guys did. But still, even out of the box, you may get rid of all the subqueries in your query with, again, only several lines of code by invoking Apache Cloud Site APIs. And this is pretty exciting because you do not need to think how your backend will execute the subqueries because you will never have them. Instead, you only think on how to execute scans, joins, aggregates, and simpler operators. Okay, now let's move on to the rule-based optimizations. So in the theory of query optimization, there is one very useful concept which is called the rule-based optimization. The idea is as follows. Instead of trying to build some monolithic query optimizer when all the possible transformations are implemented in a single place. I'm sorry for the interruption. Let me share my screen again. okay, so Yeah, so we were talking about the rule-based transformations, right? And as I mentioned, in this specific example, we observe the rule, which attempts to push the aggregation past the join, which is a pretty useful thing, which is implemented on many systems like Snowflake, Presto, and so on. And yeah, so the idea is that you split all the optimizations that you would like to have in your engine into this individual pieces called rules. And in Apache Kafka side, we have more than 100 of very useful rules that could do optimizations like this. They can change the order of joins, transpose operators with respect to each other and stuff like that. And out of the box, you have more than 100 of different rules for free. These rules are ready for use for you. And these rules, again, could be roughly split into several categories. One of the first category is the rules that attempts to transpose operators with respect to each other. For sure, one of the most widely known optimizations is the filter pushdown optimization, when you attempt to move the filter to the child operators. But in addition to this, for sure, you may also move the aggregations, you may move joins, you may not only push the filters down, but also pull them up. It may also be useful in some cases. And there are a lot of rules in Apache Kafka set which do this. The next set of rules in Apache Kafka set is the operator simplification rules, which allows you to figure out that, for example, a certain operator will never produce any rows because, for example, you have some very strange condition in the query, and it could basically collapse the operator or even a set of operators into the no-op operator. Or maybe Apache Kafka set can, for example, get rid of some aggregation operator if it realizes that the columns that you mentioned in the group by close are unique, right? And so on. And so the third group of operators is the join planning operators, which allows you to change the order of joins in your query, which is again one of the most important optimization which many mature engines have. Finally, now the question is, even if we have this large library of rules, how do we execute them? And in Apache Kafka set, you have two ways on how you may execute these rules. The first approach is the so-called iterative query planning, which is also when you have a single plan, then you pick a single rule, apply it to the plan, then you maybe move to some other rule, apply it to the plan again. And this way, you transition from one plan to the other. At any given point in time, you have no more than one, you have strictly one plan that you consider. This approach is used in the engines like Apache Spark or Presto. And in Apache Kafka set, it is implemented in the class called Heap Planner, which stands for the Heuristic Planner. And the idea of this approach is that it is very simple to implement, it is very fast to execute. But unfortunately, this approach cannot guarantee the optimality of your plan, because sometimes in order to find the best plan, I mean, the plan which yields the fastest, let's say, which yields, for example, the lowest latency for your query, you need not only to just apply some rules in a straightforward way, but you also need to consider some combinations of operators. And unfortunately, these iterative query optimizers cannot, they do not allow you to reach the optimal plan in the general case. And for example, some engineers in Presto, behind Presto, at some point in the past, they wanted to implement some, I would say, more advanced optimizer. And Spark guys in their talks also sometimes mentioned that they would like to have something more sophisticated than this to be able to find more useful plans during the query optimization. And fortunately, in Apache Kafka set, there is the second approach, which is called the cost-based optimization. In this approach, when you also operate on a certain rules, but when you apply the rule to your query, to your plan, you do not create the new plan, but instead you encode all the possible plans in a single data structure, which is called memo. And the idea of this is that whenever the rule produces the new plan, this plan is deduplicated and collapsed into this memo data structure. Inside this data structure, the equivalent plans are organized in the equivalence groups. on this slide, the equivalence groups are marketed as circles, right? For example, in the group number four, G4, you may see that we have two alternative ways of executing the query. First, we may do the aggregation, then join, then scans, or we may do the projection, then join, then aggregate, and then again scans. Right, so these are two equivalent plans that are encoded in a single data structure. And once you encode all the plans in a single data structure, you get the ability to assign costs to individual operators based on the cost model that you need to implement. And this in turn allows you to calculate the total cost of each and every operator in this data structure, which allows you to basically compare different plans with each other in terms of costs. And this allows you to get the optimal plan with respect to your cost model. So this is pretty exciting stuff. And actually, not that many engines from the big data stack have such capabilities. For example, we have the fully fledged cost-based optimizer in, for example, Cockroach, or we have it in Flink, which in turn uses Apache Calcite, right? But we do not have such cool optimizers in Spark or Presta, for example. But if you decide to use Apache Calcite, you have the ability, or maybe the luxury, I would say, to use this cost-based optimization in your engine. Next, in addition to this rule-based cost-based optimization, in the cost-based optimizer of Apache Calcite, there is also one very useful thing, which is called the cascades approach to the query optimization, which allows you not only to apply rules to your operators, but also to try to find some useful combinations of operators on different levels without the strict pattern that that they follow. For example, on the plan on the left, we see that we have some scan operators, some hash joins, some sorting. And if we look closer to these plans, we may realize that given that we have the sorting on top of the plan, it might be useful if we actually use the sorted indexes instead of the direct scans over our tables. And if we use the sorted indexes, we may also try to convert the more expensive hash join into the stream, into the merge join. And we may also try to convert the hash aggregate into the streaming aggregate, into the sorted aggregate, right? But you cannot easily encode this, this specific, combination using the rule. But instead, you need the ability to propagate the requirements to the sort order or to the distribution of data in the cluster across operators and allow the bottom operators to react to the requirements from the parent operators. And to this idea, we were first introduced in the Cascades paper something like 25 years ago. And since then, it was implemented in SQL Server, which was remarkably successful. It is also implemented in the Cockroach. It is implemented in Pivotal GreenPlum. Finally, this approach was introduced to Apache Calcite about half a year ago. And now the products which use Apache Calcite may actually benefit from this stuff if they integrate it in a proper way. So this is really a powerful and really useful technique that you use here. Finally, what I want to say about the query optimization with Apache Calcite is that Apache Calcite doesn't force you to follow some strict pattern or approach to the query optimization. Instead, it provides you a set of rules, a set of drivers to execute these rules, and also a set of some, useful visitors that can do some more sophisticated rewrites to your plans. And you may combine them in any combination you want. And usually, if you have, a lot of optimization rules, you most likely you do not want to encode to execute them at once in a single cost-based phase, because this would be most likely prohibitively expensive. For example, think of the joint order optimization problem. We all know that this is very hard to solve issue in terms of the combinatorial explosion. And usually you would like to not to try to do the exhaustive search of the different join orders for if you have more than 5, 6 or maybe 10 tables in your query, right? So in Apache Calcite, you may basically split the whole optimization into independent phases. For example, first of all, you may have the phase when you execute the filter pushdown. Then you switch to the cost-based phase when you do the gen planning. After that, you do some other rewrites in the additional heuristic phase, and so on and so on. And if you look at how Apache Calcite is integrated in the products like Apache Flink or Dremio, you may observe that they have tens of different phases when they combine different components of Apache Calcite in different ways to achieve the final result. And in this case, in this sense, Apache Calcite is extremely flexible, and it doesn't restrict you on how you should implement a query optimizer. Okay, and finally, let me describe a couple of usual use cases on how Apache Calcite is integrated in the real systems. So first of all, you may use Apache Calcite as a straightforward, as a classical query optimizer, right? So you take the parser, semantic analyzer, query optimizer, you combine them in a single routine, and now you have the ability to optimize the queries. This approach might be useful, might be used in some new database engines, for example, which do not have the good enough query optimizer out of the box. One of the examples where this approach is implemented is the GPU accelerated databases. For example, there is one database called OmniSC, which uses Apache Calcite behind the scenes. Or, for example, maybe you heard about the VoltDB database, which was inspired by some research from the Michael Stonebreaker. Again, this database uses Apache Calcite as the facility for query optimization. In this case, to implement this approach, what you need to do is that you need to first assemble your query optimizer using the existing components from the Apache Calcite, and then you should introduce your own cost model for operators, and maybe introduce some new operators which are specific to your system. For example, the typical operators, like, for example, Apache Calcite do not know how to do the joins, right? It just have the join operator, but if you would like to distinguish between, for example, hash join or nested loop join, you have to implement them by hand. This is not difficult at all, because usually the only difference between them is the cost model or maybe some set of rules which are applicable to one type of join but not applicable to the other. Similarly, if you have, for example, sorted indexes in your system, you would like to provide the new implementation of the table scan operator in Apache Calcite, which will model access to the indexes or something like this, right? So this is one of the ways on how Apache Calcite is used in the real systems. The second use case, which is also very widely used, is the federated query engine. So think of, for example, Presto. Presto doesn't have storage, right? Instead, this is the query engine, which may take the query, analyze it, and if you would like to access data from different systems, then Presto may delegate execution of some parts of the query to these target systems. Or maybe think of the foreign data wrapper in Postgres. Again, this interface could be used to provide access to some external data sources, right? And this use case renders extremely useful for many products, right? Because if you allow your users to access multiple systems through a single entry point, this could simplify a lot of business use cases. And Apache Calcite is extremely flexible and suitable for this specific approach. And even in the code base of Apache Calcite, you may see some useful examples on how you may, for example, spread the execution of the query between, for example, Mongo, Druid, and the Apache Calcite itself, right? So you just combine different rules, and then you have this ability to distribute the query execution between different systems. And if the built-in capabilities of Apache Calcite is not sufficient for you, because maybe you would like to support some specific system, I don't know, MySQL, Oracle, or I don't know, Kafka or whatsoever, you may again introduce your own optimization rules, which will model the behavior of this external system and integrate it into a single query optimizer. And in the end, you will have the query optimizer, which can spread the execution of the query between different data sources. And finally, the third very useful use case for Apache Calcite is the distributed engines. The thing here is that the main difference between the distributed and non-distributed query engines is that in the distributed world, you have to take into account how data is distributed between the nodes. For example, if you would like to do the join in the monolithic system, you just access data from which is located in your RAM, on your disk, or some other local resource, and this is it. But in the distributed system, you cannot do the, for example, equi join like this. Instead, you need to ensure that records with the matching join keys are located on a single node, and this is not necessarily the case, right? So you need to take into account how you will reshuffle or redistribute data between the nodes during the execution of the query. And Apache Calcet, again, very powerful here, because for every operator that you optimize in your query planner, you may define the requirements to the underlying source that this underlying source should satisfy. For example, on this slide, we see the join between the employee table and department table. And during the optimization, we may instruct the child nodes that department table should be sharded by the department ID, and the employee table should be sharded by the department ID as well. And this way, if, for example, the employee table is not already sharded by this key, then Apache Calcet can inject some special operator, which is called exchange on the slide, to model the redistribution of data. And of course, we know from our experience that the redistribution of data in the cluster is usually a pretty expensive process, right? So you may also implement the cost model for this exchange operator so that the more, let's say, exchanges you have in your plan, the more costly the plan would be. And so this would allow Apache Calcet to find the plan which produces as less redistributions of data as possible. Right, so, and this very nice capability of Apache Calcet were extensively used by Apache Flink, Apache Hive, by Apache Drill, by Dremio. So a lot of systems in the big data stack actually use this, use Apache Calcet, because it is very, very suitable for this distributed use case. So, okay, so this is also a couple of examples of the projects or companies which use Apache Calcet. I think that I already mentioned most of them. Maybe I didn't mention the IMDG type of products like Apache Ignite or Hazelcast. They use or now or are currently integrating Apache Calcet. Yeah, Apache Calcet is also widely used in many large tech companies like Uber, LinkedIn, Alibaba. It is used in Intel. It is used in many, many different companies, actually, because it is so flexible, right? And actually, in our daily business practice, in our company, we also observe a huge interest to Apache Calcet, even in non-technical companies. And actually, this is it from my side. And to summarize, we discussed that Apache Calcet is a framework which comes with a set of useful tools to build the query optimizers. Specifically, it has a parser for syntax analysis, it has a semantic analyzer, it has the very convenient intermediate representation, and it has a lot of useful optimization rules and other tools to optimize this intermediate representation to find a better plan. And generally, if you would like to, you need to understand that if you would like to introduce the SQL interface to your system, then with Apache Calcet, it is actually achievable with much lower efforts than if you otherwise would do it from scratch, right? Because with Apache Calcet, you may generally implement some minimal viable product in a matter of maybe a couple of weeks or a couple of months, right? And after that, you may incrementally make your optimizer more and more complicated, right? So I would really encourage you to take a look at this tool because it could be really useful for you. Okay, so this is it from my side. Thank you for your attention. And if you have some questions, let's switch to the Q&A.